I'd like to start by saying that autonomous vehicles are being designed to save lives. That's the first thing that you have to understand. The World Health Organization puts the number at 1.25 million. 1.25 million people die every year in car accidents. If you do the numbers, that's 3,400 people a day. Every day, 3,400 people die on the roads in the world. And so we're making autonomous vehicles to save lives. I'm an optimist. I believe we're going to save all the lives, and there's not going to be anybody that's going to die. People that have to do actuarial work, the insurance agencies are looking at a reduction of about 90%. 90% of car accidents will be reduced by autonomous vehicles. That being said, nevertheless, we can conjure up scenarios which are unavoidable accidents. A truck is driving down the road and it drops its load, and now another car is going to just smash right into it or drive into somebody. Somebody runs into the street and no technology can identify them fast enough and he gets run over, or the car has to turn away. There will be some kinds of accidents. And so this brings us into kind of a ethical dilemma of how do we program the car? How does the car make a choice of who will live and who will die? Now, as was introduced, I'm an engineer and I'm a rabbi. As an engineer, that doesn't put me in a position to be telling anybody how to drive or anybody how to program. You know, I just write the if-then-else statement and we leave the ethics for somebody else. And that somebody else could be a moral philosopher or a rabbi. So it turns out that I am a rabbi, but these issues are way too huge for my shoulders. And so what I'm going to do today is I'm not going to tell anybody how to drive. I'm not going to tell anybody how to program. I'm going to bring to you thousands of years of sources. As was said, Judaism has been talking about these moral dilemmas for a long, long time. What I want to do is I want to bring to you all of the ancient sources and modern sources. Modern post-scheme have also been dealing with these kinds of problems. As you'll see, it's a very, very difficult question. And as I said, I'm not telling you how to drive. I'm not telling you how to program. And what was said here that, you know, now there's computer scientists among the crowd, that they're going to have to face these questions. It's true, you'll have to face them, but I'm not so sure that you'll be the ones applying them with your computer science hat on. Because even at Mobileye, where I'm known as the rabbi of Mobileye, I'm not telling anybody how to program. Amnon Shashua, who is the founder and current CEO of Mobileye, said, Mobileye is actually not going to make any moral decisions. We are not going to decide. After we talk about how somebody should drive or not drive, or how the car as a computerized driver should make its ethical decision, Mobileye will not make that decision. We will program however any government body or any car manufacturer, whoever the customer is, that says, you know, I want you to decide in such a case like X or Y, we'll write the if-then-else however you want. But we won't make that decision because we're not moral ethicists, we're computer scientists. So there is some logic to that, and he also basically reduces his responsibility. We'll talk about really who should be making that decision at the very end of this talk. But to start off, you know, the classic problem, which I think probably most of you are familiar with, is known as the trolley problem. For those of you who aren't familiar with the trolley problem, you're a trolley driver driving down the tracks, you've lost your brakes, and it turns out that there are five people tied to the track in front of you. If you do nothing, you're going to now run over five people and kill them. The only option that you have at your disposal is to pull the lever, which switches the track, and the trolley will now go onto a single track over here. And so now you have saved the five people by pulling this lever. The problem is that there is one person tied to the track over here, and you're going to murder him. And so the question becomes, do you save five people at the expense of one? Do you murder somebody actively in order to not drive over five people passively? So now this question has been asked and dealt with for many, many years, and turns out that the trolley problem was put forth by a philosophy professor by the name of Philippa Foote in 1969. She came up with this as a sort of ethical dilemma to try and make people think about the problems and difficulties of solving ethical problems. And as was mentioned here, unfortunately today people are doing surveys to answer these questions. And yes, we do have more substantial ways to answer them, which I hope you'll see tonight. Now, Since she's asked this question, as I said, many, many people have tried to answer it. You can take the ethicists and put them into two groups, okay? There are the consequentialists. They look at the consequences, or a subcategory of them is known as the utilitarians. They look at the utility. They look at the consequences. What will happen if we decide like X? What will happen if we decide like Y? So they'll look at a simple or difficult case as the trolley problem, and they'll say, very simple, 5 against 1, much better consequences if 5 people live than if 5 people die. And so a consequentialist will say, obviously you turn the wheel and you save the 5 people. The other group of ethicists say, no, that's a little bit too simplistic. And so we are what are called deontologists, okay? Deontologists is really a fancy word. Deon in Greek means duty. Deontologists are the people who follow their duties. They follow their rules. We have rules that we decide by. We don't break the rules. We have a rule, thou shalt not murder. So you cannot turn the trolley and run over the one guy because that is actively murdering somebody. And I don't care if there are 5 people or 50 people. We have a rule, don't murder. So that's how the two sides get split up. If in surveys that they've asked this question, intuitively, the vast majority of people will answer like the utilitarian and say, look, you know, I mean, 5 people, 1 person, I mean, we should save more people. And intuitively, it sounds true, but then the problem comes when you start putting names on those people, when you start putting titles on those people. What if the 5 people are 5 mafia guys? What if the 1 person is the president of the United States? No politics. So the question becomes much more difficult when you start trying to play God. And so that's what I want to try to do for you today, is I want to take Jewish sources and try to answer these questions, or if not answer them, at least give you some depth to deal with these questions. So before we go to the trolley problem, there's another more simpler problem. It's not so simple, but at least it removes the number game. And we, instead of talking about 5 against 1, let's talk about 1 against 1. So there's a modern philosopher by the name of Jason Miler. He came up with a subset of the trolley problem. He calls it the tunnel problem. So the tunnel problem basically says you're driving a car down the road. It's a 1-lane highway, and you're about to go into a tunnel. You lost your brakes, and there's a guy standing in the middle of the tunnel. You have 2 options. Either you run over him, or you turn the wheel and you commit suicide, you drive into the wall. Or we could say it's like off a cliff, whatever it is, those are your options. Either you die or he dies, okay? Somebody is going to die. How should you decide? So now, the one-on-one case is dealt very clearly in Mishnah and Ohalot. It says, Ha'isha shehi makshe leled, Yetze yatsa rubo ein nogin bo she'ein dochin nefesh mipnei nefesh. So the Mishnah is addressing a very common and unfortunate problem in ancient times, that women often had great difficulty in childbirth, and it often was a question of life against life. Either the baby's going to live or the mother's going to live. Who are you going to save? So the Mishnah tells us that once the baby's head is out, it is now a full-fledged person. And when we have 2 full-fledged persons in front of us, and we don't care if it's a mother or an old lady or a baby or a girl or a boy, no, we don't start playing God. Once you have 2 people in front of you, no one can judge between one person and the other. Ein dochin nefesh mipnei nefesh. We do not set aside one soul for another. That's it. We let nature take its course, and whoever survives, survives. Okay, so now that's very simple and easy to understand when you're talking about 2 people that you're not involved with, but what about if it's your life? How about if it's you and the other guy? So there's a famous Gemara in Psachim. It says as follows, De'ata lakame de Rabba. So someone came before Rabba. Amar le mari durai, amar li zil katilia katile laplanya, ve'ilo katilne lacha. So basically what he said is the governor told me, either you go murder this person, Plony, or I'm going to kill you. So now, what do you do? That's the question that this person put before Rabba. And Rabba said very simple, Amar le liktelucha velo tiktol. You must be killed, and you must not kill. And now he explains why. My chazi didama didach sumak tfei. How do you see that his blood is redder, or sorry, that your blood is redder? Dilma dama dahu gavra suma tfei. Perhaps his blood is redder than yours. Again, we see exactly the same kind of egalitarianism that we saw in the Mishnah. People can't judge between people. I can't say that my blood is redder than your blood. You can't say that your blood is redder than his blood. In a decision of life against life, we cannot make such a decision, and so therefore this is a yareg val yavor. You have to be killed and not violate this cardinal sin of killing anybody else. This Gemara is accepted universally, but the Tosfot come and say, okay, I understand I'm not allowed to kill somebody else to save myself, right? Murder, thou shalt not murder, we're deontologists, don't do that. However, asked the Tosfot, what if I didn't actually murder him? In fact, the governor, he didn't come and say, kill this plony. He said the plony was a baby, and the governor just said, let me drop you on this baby, and you will crush the baby to death, but you won't have done it. So the Tosfot answer, and they say here, avalhecha delo avid maase, kegon shemashlichin oto al hatinok, ומתעמך מסתברה שאין חייב למסור עצמו דלא עביד מעשה. So he says, in this case, you are actually not doing anything. לא עביד מעשה. You didn't do anything. You were just passively taking part in this thing, and so therefore, you don't have to give up your life, says the Tosfot. The Tosfot again says, if you are going to kill somebody actively, you're forbidden. If you were going to be involved passively, you would be permitted, meaning you wouldn't have to give up your life to avoid killing somebody passively. Rav Chaim of Brisk explains it in his Chidushim on the Gemara. So he says the logic of the Tosfot is as follows. We said we don't know whose blood is redder. So, say the Tosfot, if I don't know whose blood is redder, I mean, okay, I can't kill you because maybe your blood is redder, but why should I die for you? Maybe my blood is redder. And so the Tosfot say you don't have to give up your life if you're involved passively. However, says Rav Chaim of Brisk, the Rambam uses exactly the same logic to argue the opposite side of the coin. And he says, if I don't know if your blood is redder or my blood is redder, that means I have no justification to even be involved in killing you passively. And so the Rambam would say, you are not allowed to be involved in any kind of killing, not actively and not passively. So now the Minchat Chinuch sees this Tosfot and says, you know, we have support from a story with Rabbi Akiva for the Tosfot position. And he brings a famous Gemara in Baba Metzia. It says, Shnaim shahayu mahalachin baderech. There were two guys on the road in the desert, far from the city, ubiyad echad mehen kiton shel mayim, and one of them had a canteen of water. Im shotin shnehem metim, if they both share it and they both drink, they will both die. Im shote echad mehen magia liyishuv, but if one guy drinks the water, he has enough to get to the city, but the other guy will die. What should they do? Darash ben Petora. Mutav sheyishtu shnehen veyamutu va'al yireh echad mehen bemitato shel chavero. So Ben Petora says it's better that they should share the water and both die, so that they both don't. Neither one sees his friend die in his hands, as it were. Ad sheba Rabbi Akiva velimed. But then Rabbi Akiva finally came and he learned a pasuk. V'chai achicha imach. Your brother should live with you. Chayecha kodmin l'chayecha v'recha. So he says from this pasuk that your brother should live with you means that you should be alive, which means that your life takes precedence over the other person. So the Minchat Chinuch learns from this Gemara. Look, you see that just like we learn from Rabbi Akiva that you don't have to give the water to the other person, he dies and you're basically involved passively. So too, that's just like the Tosfot case. But then Rav Chaim Brisk says, no. That's not just the same. There's a very big difference between what Rabbi Akiva said and what the Tosfot said. Because what the Tosfot said was, I'm going to be involved in a passive killing. Rabbi Akiva said, you're not involved. You can refrain from saving. I'm refraining from, I didn't kill my friend that I didn't give him the water. I just chose not to save him. That's very different that I chose to be dropped on top of him and kill him. Okay, and Reb Chaim goes even further and says, and it took Rabbi Akiva a pasuk from the Torah to prove his point, just to refrain from saving. All the more so you'd need scriptural proof to allow passive killing. So Reb Chaim paskins like the Rambam and says you may not be involved in any kind of killing, not actively and not passively. Okay, so now that we understand that, we can get a little bit closer to our tunnel problem, but there's one more piece of information that you need to understand, and that's committing suicide, okay? We said if the governor comes and says, take this gun and shoot this guy, you can't do it. You have to let the governor kill you, okay? And we said that, you know, according to the Rambam and Rav Chaim, you can't be involved passively, that he lets you throw you, that you let the governor throw you on the baby. But do I have to commit suicide to avoid one of the three cardinal sins? So there are three opinions. Some people say you're forbidden to commit suicide under any circumstances, even if it is to avoid a cardinal sin. Some people say you're permitted to commit suicide because you want to save the other person. And then some people, actually the Ramban, says you are obligated to commit suicide in order to avoid one of the three cardinal sins. If somebody says go kill somebody and the only way you can avoid it is by killing yourself, you have to do that according to the Ramban. So now that would mean that in the tunnel problem, you would have to commit suicide. However, there's a modern rabbi whose name is Dikovsky. And Rav Dikovsky explains that the Ramban only would require you to commit suicide to avoid actively killing somebody. But being involved passively versus actively killing yourself, he would not say. You follow? So even the Ramban would not say you need to commit suicide in order to avoid passively killing somebody. So now with all those pieces of information together, we can answer the trolley problem. The tunnel problem. But the tunnel problem is also split into two cases. There's the straight tunnel and there's the curved tunnel. Okay? So now, you're driving along a straight road, you lost your brakes, and now there's a person standing in front of you. You can either drive over him. You're not putting the gas, you don't have any brakes, you're not moving the steering wheel, you're just what is called passively continuing forward. So that's one option you have. The other option is to actively take the steering wheel and turn it and go into the wall or go off the cliff, whatever it is, to kill yourself. So from what we've heard, how many people say that you have to commit suicide? Very good. You don't have to commit suicide, which means you have permission to drive over the guy passively, okay? Now, we go to the curved tunnel case. So now you're driving along and the guy's over here. The tunnel goes like this. There's a wall in front of you, okay? You're going to have to turn the wheel in order to follow the road, and now you've actively run over the guy, right? So how many people say you can turn the wheel? Very good. You cannot turn the wheel because everybody says you can't actively kill anybody to save yourself. We'll do questions at the end, I'm sorry, because otherwise it will get complicated. All right, so what that is saying is that you have to remain passive and go into the wall. But there's one last piece of information I didn't tell you before you go driving into any tunnel walls, and that's the question, what is this guy doing in the middle of the road? So there's a book that was written by a small group of guys that work out of Rav Asher Weiss's Kollel in Jerusalem. They have a little institute called the Institute for Halacha and Modern Issues. I sat with them also when they were working on the book that discusses all of these problems of ethics and autonomous vehicles. And they say that if the person is in the road illegally, they have no business there. They just decided to have lunch in the middle of a tunnel. So now they have forfeited all of their rights because they basically become a rodef. A rodef is somebody that is chasing somebody else to kill them, right? This person sitting in the road is, as it were, chasing you to kill you because he's going to cause you to drive off the cliff or drive into the wall, right? And so he is now a rodef, and we all know that the din rodef is that he has to be stopped in any way, even at the cost of his life. So if a person is in the road illegally, so all bets are off and you're allowed to run over them and not kill yourself, okay? But if they are there legally, so then you have no right to actively run over them. Okay, so now we can go to the trolley problem. Okay, so now, like we said, the trolley problem is the one against the many. It turns out that the Jews have been talking about the trolley problem a few hundred or thousand years before Philippa Foot came on the scene. There's a Gemara, Yushalmi, in Truma, Trumot. It says as follows. Siyot b'nei adam sh'ayu malchin b'derech, u'pagu lahem goyim, v'amru tnu lanu echad mikem v'na'arog oto, v'im lav hare anu horgin et kulchem. So it says as follows, there's a group of Jews on a trek or in a village, whatever it is, and a group of non-Jews come and they surround them and they say, give us a Jew or we kill you all. The one against the many. And by the way, Rav Maidan has an article about this. Rav Maidan's a Rosh Yeshiva at Har Etzion. I spoke with him at length about these Gemaras. He said this Gemara was written in blood. So this isn't a theoretical ethical dilemma. So it says as follows, Afilu kulan neragin lo yimsaru nefesh achat mi Yisrael. Even if all of the Jews will be killed, you do not hand over one soul of Israel. So that's pretty straightforward for your trolley problem answer. Now, just to complete the whole story so you guys know the rest of the Gemara, although you'll see in a minute that it's not so relevant for our question, Yichdu lehen echad kagon sheva ben bichri yimsaru oto velo yarogu. So it says, if the goyim came and said, give us Sheva ben Bichri, give us Moshe, give us this guy, they said a name. So now you can hand over that person because evidently they have some beef with him and it's not that they just want to kill a Jew. Amar Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish, v'hu sheyehe chayav mitaka Sheva ben Bichri. So Reish Lakish says, the only way that you can hand over somebody is if they set him by name and he already is liable for capital punishment. He already has the death penalty on him. Otherwise, you can't hand him over because they'll kill him. And why did you just kill somebody that had no reason to be killed? Rabbi Yochanan amar, afal pisha eino chayav mita kesheva ben bichri. And Rabbi Yochanan said, no. As long as they just said a name, they have an issue with him, and he's like a problem. He's going to basically cause all the Jews to be killed, and so you can hand him over. Just for your general edification, Reish Lakish, the Rambam Paskins like Reish Lakish, and the Meiri Paskins like Rabbi Yochanan. The Meiri asks, how can it be? You know, Reish Lakish is the student of Rabbi Yochanan, and of course we always Paskin like the teacher and not the student, but the Rambam feels that this is a case where we need to be very strict, let's say, and save all of Jewish lives. There's an ethic that's being expressed here. Okay, so now, if we only take this source, and this is the source that all the poskim use to answer this trolley problem in modern times, so basically we have the answer to the trolley problem. You can't hand over somebody. You can't kill somebody. You can't sacrifice the individual to save the many. Now, this is a very difficult problem because, you know, it's hard to say that. And so the Chazon Ish actually has a whole discussion on this. And the Chazon Ish was asked, it turns out that there was a trolley problem with a car in Bnei Brak in the 50s, and he was asked this question, what should the driver have done? Now, the Chazon Ish didn't want to address it specifically that people should know that it was about this specific case, and so he made up a parallel case. He calls it the arrow dilemma, the chetz. Okay, I will call it the missile because a missile dilemma makes it a little bit more real for us. So he says, imagine that there's a group of people over here, and there's an arrow, there's a missile coming, and it's going to kill all the people. And you are watching, and you happen to have the technological means to divert the missile. You can push the missile to the side. You will save all the people, but there's one guy over here that the missile is going to kill. Okay? The missile, the arrow, the trolley, the autonomous vehicle. Okay, so now the Chazon Ish says, What should you do? So now he explains as follows. Okay. Efshar, delo dami demosrim echad lahariga. So he says it could be that this missile case is actually not like the marauder case in the Gemara in Trumot where you're handing over a Jew. Okay, so he says like this, dehatam hamesirahi pu'ula achzarit shel harigat nefesh. In the case of handing over the Jew, that is a brutal case of murder, okay? Or sorry, of killing a soul. It's a brutal case of killing. V'apu'ula zu ein hatzalat acherim b'teva shel apu'ula. And the salvation of all the rest of the Jews is not inherent in this action. Okay, so listen carefully what he's doing. He's saying, when you hand over the Jew, this is an act of killing. Okay, I'm now going to hand this Jew to be killed. That's not inherently saving it. The people are now indirectly going to be saved because now the goyim will go away and leave them alone. But my action of handing them, this is an action of killing, not an action of saving. That is as opposed to moving the missile. The missile is about to hit, explode on this whole group. When I move the missile, I have just saved the group. This is not an act of killing. This is an act of saving. Now, it turns out that there's a guy here that I'm going to kill, but my action is a saving action as opposed to taking the Jew, which is a killing action. Okay? So that's what the Chazon Ish wants to try to differentiate between these cases and see if we can't come up with a different answer to the trolley problem. So, okay. So now he says, okay. B'teva apula. Ela hamikre garam achshav hatzala la'achirim. By diverting the missile, I have now... By giving the Jew, I have caused the saving of the whole group. Now he says another interesting point, which is very important. Gam hatzalat ha'achirim kashur b'ma shemosrim lahariga nefesh miYisrael. So now he says the second point. The first point is that this is a killing action and this is a saving action. But there's another thing that's very important to understand. And he says that in the case of the marauder case, when I hand over the Jew, the only way to save the group is by killing the Jew. This guy doesn't die, these people don't get saved. You understand? I have to have this person die in order to save these people. That's a very terrible thing. That basically violates Immanuel Kant's rule that you should never treat people or yourself as a means, but rather as an end. Now, to make this point very clear, there's a very interesting article called The Trolley Problem. It was written by Judith Jarvis Thompson. She's a philosophy professor, published in 1985 in the Yale Journal of Law. In that paper, she basically goes through all the arguments of the Chazon Ish. It's amazing. And now, when she talks about this case of that you need this guy to die, so she brings a very interesting dilemma, which she calls the transplant dilemma. And she says like this, I'm a doctor, and I have five patients that need five different organ transplants. If they don't get those organs, they are all going to die. Okay, I need five organs to save my five patients, but I don't have five organs. One day I'm sitting in my office and a young guy comes in for his annual checkup. Five organs, five people. You understand? If I, the doctor, now go and kill this one guy, I can save my five patients. Okay, but you understand that that means this guy has to die in order for me to save these people. And that's exactly what the Chazon Ish is saying. In the handing over of the Jew, he has to die. And so that's very bad. No one would say that you should kill an innocent person in order to save five people. Yeah, it's five against one, save five people. But no one would say that you can use a person as a means to an end of saving another five people. Okay? So now you're beginning to understand the difference between five and one is not so simple. Okay? So now, the question then becomes, if I can't do this, back up. So now what the Chazon Ish is saying is that in the case of handing over the Jew, that is killing the person has to die to save the people. But in the case of the missile, no one has to die. I don't need somebody to die to save the group. All I need to do is move the missile, and I save the group. It just so happens that incidentally, there's a guy over there that's going to die. I don't want him to die. I don't want him to be there. He'll be dead because he's just in the wrong place at the wrong time. So now the Chazon Ish goes on and he says basically what I just explained. He says as follows, Aval hatayat ha-chetz mitzad ze letzad acher, hi be'ikara pu'ulat hatzalah. Moving the missile is an act of salvation. Ve'eina kshura klal b'harigat ha-yachid she-betzad acher. And it's not connected in any way to the guy that's going to die on the other side. Just so happens that incidentally there's a guy there. So he says, now, because I'm not really killing anybody on purpose, and I'm really saving all this whole group, so as long as I've basically avoided any deontological violations. So now Judaism does want you to save as many people as possible. You know, let's take the case of pure salvation. There's two islands, I'm on a boat, and I have enough gas to go to one island and back. That's it. On this island there are five people, on this island there are one. There's no question I should go save the five people, okay? I'm not violating anything. I'm saving as many people as possible. Afterwards, okay? So the point is that as long as I'm not killing anybody, okay? So in this case now, the Chazon Ish goes and says as follows. V'halo lulianos u'papus ne'ergu b'Yisrael atzil Yisrael komosha katav Rashi b'Tanit. So he says, and we have evidence of this. In the Gemara in Ta'anit, Rashi brings a story that Lulianus and Papus saved all the Jewish people. There was a governor that his daughter was killed, and the townspeople said the Jews did it, so the governor came and said, I'm going to kill all the Jews if somebody doesn't fess up. And so Lulianus and Papus said, okay, we did it in order to save all the people. And so it says, Va'amar she'ein kol birya yechola la'amod b'mechitzatan. And so the Gemara says that in great praise that because Lulianus and Papus gave their lives to save all the people, no one can reach their place in heaven. Basically, the Chazon Ish is bringing this as evidence that we do have an ethic of saving as many people as possible, as long as we're not killing anybody. And now he goes on and says as follows, Mihu, however, everything I just told you, he says, Mihu hacha batayat ha-chetz gara. He says, however, everything I just told you is not exactly right. The case of moving the arrow, of moving the missile, is weaker than I've made it out to be. And he says, "Dehoreg b'yadayim," because when I kill somebody with my own hands, when I move that missile, it's true it was an act of salvation. It's true I saved everybody. It's true I didn't want to kill anybody, but I did. And so he says, that's called harigaba yadayim. That's called killing with your own hands. And he says, velo matzinu ela demosrin. And he said, we've never found any evidence in Jewish law or in Jewish lore that says you can kill somebody with your own hands even for any great purpose. So you can't kill somebody. He says, we only found that you could hand over a Jew. And he said, that's only in the case when they gave the guy's name, like Sheva ben Bichri. De Mored Malchut Haya, and he even quotes the Reish Lakish's opinion that he says, and that was because anyway he was liable for death. And so he says, Tzarich Iyun. He ends the whole discussion that it needs investigation. Okay, and it should be known that this whole section is a commentary on the Gemara and Sanhedrin and is not found in his Piskei Halacha where he says, this is the rule, this is the rule. No, this is not the rule. This is a discussion, and he says, I throw up my hands. Okay? Now, it turns out that several other rabbis following the Chazon Ish have tried to give this iyun that he called for, this investigation. So the Minchat Asher, Rav Asher Weiss, says that I want to try to understand where was the Chazon Ish coming from? How could he have even proposed this? Of course you can't kill anybody with your own hands. How could he even bring the whole discussion? So Rav Asher Weiss brings several possibilities. In the end, he says, perhaps the Chazon Ish was referring to a case where you put a treis, he says. You put a force field over the people. And so when the missile came, it bounced off of the force field and it passively killed the other guy. And so we saw that, you know, passively you could save somebody, and so maybe that's what it is, but he also ends very clearly, "V'tzarich iyun gadol b'kol zeh." This needs a lot of investigation. So he also doesn't answer the trolley problem question, okay? The only person who actually answers it very decisively is the Tzitz Eliezer. So the Tzitz Eliezer quotes the Chazon Ish. He says he's talking about a car, and he's talking about the trolley problem. He's talking about saving the one, the many at the expense of the one. And he says, I don't even know how he could even bring all of this up. He says that Rabbeinu Yonah, who was the cousin, I believe, of the Ramban, he wrote as follows. Says as follows: Hare lanu she Rabbeinu Yonah zal heiniach lanu klal gadol baze shehakav manches hitvu lanu chazal al kagon ze shel sheilat nefashot hu livchor liyot baze b'matzav shel shev ve'al ta'aseh. He says that Rabbeinu Yonah has expressed for us the line of thought of Chazal, of our sages, that say that in cases of questionable souls or murder or killing or any such question, we have to remain passive. Just like we saw with the baby being born, we can't judge between a soul and a soul, and so we have to remain passive. So he says this is not just a specific case, this is a general principle, that in cases when we do not know how to decide between a person and another person, we have to remain passive. But he goes on further, and he says, in killing, in a for sure killing that somebody is going to die, ein chiluk bein yachid lerabim. There is no difference between an individual and a majority of people. Velo amrinan derabim adifa. And we do not say that the multitude is to be preferred over the individual. So he says it's straight. Deontology at its best. You cannot sacrifice the individual for the greater good of the multitude. You cannot sacrifice the individual for the multitude. So now this is a very, very difficult pill to swallow. And so perhaps I offer you a couple pieces of philosophy. The fact of the matter is that before the Torah was given that said that man was created B'Tselem Elohim, in the image of God, so all the ancient peoples of the world were busy sacrificing individuals for the greater good. In fact, the individual had no value as an individual. When I say they were sacrificing the individual, of course, you know, they were sacrificing them literally, killing kids on an altar to get rain for the public. So all of a sudden, Judaism came along and said, no, their individual has value as an individual. The individual is created in the image of God. And so this is really taking the value of the individual to the nth degree. This is the value of saying, put your money where your mouth is. If the individual has such great value, so then you cannot sacrifice him under any circumstances. And we see that also in the Mishnah. The Mishnah is a famous Mishnah in Sanhedrin. It says, bara adam yechidi lelamedcha shekol ha-me'abed nefesh echad ma'ale alav ha-katuv ki'ilu ibed olam male v'chol ha-mekayem nefesh echad ma'ale alav ha-katuv ki'ilu kiyem olam male. That somebody who saves even one soul is as if he saved the whole world. And by the way, I think it's important to say that there are two versions of this Mishnah. One that says, if you saved a single soul, and another one says, if you saved a single soul in Israel. And I read a very interesting academic analysis of all the texts, and it goes through and tries to find out what was the original Mishnah, and there's clear evidence, without a shadow of a doubt, that the original Mishnah said you should save a single soul, period. It does not say save a single soul of the Jewish people. This is a very, very universal Mishnah that says every person is equal to the whole world. And later on, it got inserted that it was for every, that it was basically save a Jewish soul. And you can imagine, because of the diaspora and how we were under fire from all the peoples around us, how this got inserted. Nevertheless, we should understand that really this Mishnah is telling us that everybody in the world was created in the image of God, and every soul that you save, Jewish or not Jewish, is saving the whole world. So then that brings us to Rav Kook, who answers this question about the Rabbim versus the Yachid, the multitude versus the individual. Rav Kook says as follows in Shuta Mishpat Kohen, Ein b'kochenu likboa erko shel olam male shel Yachid, l'umat erko shel olam male shel Rabbim. We cannot estimate the value of the whole world that is one person versus the whole world that is many people. Basically, what he's saying is that each individual has infinite worth. And if you take one infinity and put it against five infinities, you still get an identity. We cannot judge between the multitude or the individual. You cannot sacrifice the individual to save the multitude. So that's basically how this answer comes out. Except there's still a voice saying, but really? You're not going to save five people at the expense of one? You're driving a car, and all you have to do is turn the wheel and you'll save all these people? So that voice was actually expressed by Rav Yaakov Maidan, again, the Rosh Yeshiva of Har Etzion. I spoke with him at length many times about this issue. And he said to me as follows. He said, look, let's say, God forbid, you were in an accident and you were taken before an impartial judge and you had to explain your actions. And you went before the judge and you said, I ran over the five people because I didn't want to turn the wheel and actively kill the one guy that was on the side of the road. Or you went to the judge and you said, he asked you, why did you kill that person? And you said, I turned my wheel and ran him over because there were five people here and I saved the five people. So for Rav Maidan, it's obvious who's going to have the easier time explaining himself to the judge. Obviously, for Rav Maidan, he says that you should save as many people as possible, even if that means that you'll run over one person. So I said to Rav Maidan, I said, but what about the Gemara and Trumot? What about, it's everybody uses it. The Chazon Ish, the Rav Asher, the Tzitz Eliezer, he said, I am dust at their feet, but I beg to differ. So I said, but the Gemara says, he said, that Gemara is talking about a time of war. That Gemara is talking about a time when the Jewish people are under attack. And so that Gemara is talking about preserving the morale of the people. You don't just hand somebody over because you want to keep the people united. So I said, okay, I can understand that. But then what do you do with the Gemara in Psachim that said that we can't judge between blood and blood? My blood is not redder than his blood. One blood is not redder than the other bloods. What do you do with that? So he said, Tzarich Iyun. He said it needs investigation. And he didn't answer the question. At this point, that's basically where this discussion ends. And so now that brings us to the autonomous vehicle. So now everything I've told you to this point is basically a discussion about a human driver getting into a human problem. But what about a digital driver? What about a car that's programmed beforehand to act in a certain situation? So now when I was asked this exact question, so I said, there's no question here. Computers are the agents of people. Whatever is allowed for a person is allowed for a computer. Whatever is not allowed for a person is not allowed for a computer. We just went through this discussion. However we come out of the discussion for a human driver, that's how the discussion should come out for the digital driver. So when I went to speak with the rabbis at Rav Asher Weiss's Institute of Halacha and Future Technologies, so they said, there's a difference. And what they said was, as follows. They said, look, when a person gets into a trolley problem, he's looking at real people in real time. He's now got to make a decision between Reuven, Shimon, and Levi, and Yehuda. He's got to make a decision. Am I going to kill these people right now, or am I going to kill this guy right now? And he's got to make a decision, life and life. That's very, very different from the computer, where there's a guy sitting in Har Chotzvim, Jerusalem, who's busy writing if-then-elses, okay? And it's going to get put into a system that's going to get on the road in another 2 years, and who knows when it will ever get into a trolley problem, and then it's going to have to make a decision. So what they said is actually an expansion of what Rabbi Josh Flug wrote in a YU article on the subject, where he said, basically, we can apply the Chazon Ish, that really, in this case, it's not Hariga B'Yadayim. It's not really killing somebody, because I'm not even moving the missile over here to actually see somebody and kill somebody. It's not, I'm programming a car to save lives. And that's what the rabbis at Rav Asher Weiss's Kola said. They said, the autonomous vehicle is being made for one reason, to save lives. It has a modus operandi that it does everything that it can do to save lives. And so also when it would get into a case where there was a choice of multiple choice of who's gonna live and who's gonna die, again, the modus operandi of the whole system is save as many lives as possible. And they're not looking at Reuven, Shimon, Levi, and Yehuda. They're looking at statistical man A and statistical man B. And so when you're programming that system, you are basically trying to raise the odds of everybody in the world surviving. And so they come out on the side that a human driver is very different than a digital driver, and that in a computer's case, you would save the many and at the expense of the individual. Now, with that said, I would like to also discuss one other point, and this is, which we referred to in the very beginning, and that is who decides. So I counted five agents, five different types of people, institutions that could make the decision how the car is going to be programmed. So the first one would be the programmer. He's the guy writing the code, let him decide. Not a good idea. I programmed software and hardware and systems for 35 years. You don't want me making a decision. All I want to do is go home early. Right? So now if I have to think more and add more code and more testing, I'm just going to do what's easier. So you don't want, the programmer should not make the moral decision. So then the second agent is the technology supplier, Mobileye. They're making the system. They're supplying the technology. Maybe they should decide. But really, they shouldn't decide either, because they have a very, very significant agenda. They want to sell as many chips as possible with as big a margin as possible. So they want to do things as cheaply as possible. Every extra if-then-else that I put in is more money, more time, more testing, more programming in hardware. It's more silicon. It's more expensive chips. The technology supplier is not a good arbiter of morality in this case. So then the next institution up would be the car supplier, Mercedes, BMW. They're the ones who are bringing the product to the market. But again, they fall into the same category as having an agenda to sell as many cars as possible for as cheap as possible. And whether that means taking surveys, who will buy the most cars and will program it like they want, that's also, they're also not a good arbiter of morality. So then you go to the car owner. He bought the car, it's his car. And many people have come to me and said, I want to decide. Well, that's very nice, but you know, as a car driver, basically you want to say, everybody out of my way, I want to go to work, right? And they actually did a survey. They've done surveys and they said, would you buy an autonomous vehicle that would save thousands of lives every day? For sure, everybody signs up. Would you buy that car if it killed you to save those other? No, I don't want that car. So they, too, have a very significant agenda. Basically, I want my life saved. I'm not saying, by the way, that the car shouldn't save the driver. I'm just saying that that's another moral dilemma that needs to be answered by a third-party objective decisor. So finally, that basically leaves the government. The government is the ones who are in charge of all of society and of the regulations. And so even though I know that people will say, no, but governments are corrupt, etc., from what I understand today, they're still putting together ethical bodies, and there are people making ethical groups where they're coming to try to make some ethical decision and make recommendations to governments as to what would be the right way to program and what wouldn't be the right way to program it. So that's basically the way the chips fall out today. I want to just end the way we started. And that is that autonomous vehicles are going to save lives. Even though we just discussed these very hairy situation of getting into a trolley problem, ask yourself, how many trolley problems have you ever heard about, read about in real life with people drivers? There will be far, far less with digital drivers. These cars are being programmed to be incredibly safe, mathematically programmed, so they never get into these kinds of situations. It's possible that such a situation could happen, and therefore we need to talk about these things. The car obviously needs to be programmed to handle all kinds of situations, but the fact of the matter is that this is really more of an academic exercise than applied technology. At the end of the day, autonomous vehicles are going to save lives. Thank you very much.